you, and I'm sure for our German colleague here, you want to understand all of this. Anyway, I want to welcome you to an event here. This morning at ITI, I'm just hosting in partnership with our colleagues at the German Embassy on essentially Industry 4.0 or the Industrial Internet. It goes by a lot of different names, but essentially it's the idea of putting intelligence into the manufacturing production system. So I'm Rob Atkinson, I lead ITIF. We're going to have a great discussion this morning. I'm going to introduce the panelists, and then we're going to do this really at a dialogue. We will end at precisely 10:30, and you should have plenty of time to ask some questions a little bit later. But I just want to make one overarching point, because it's interesting, I think, that this is now coming to the fore. For a long, long time, manufacturers have used advanced information technology for improving production. We had CAD, or what's called computer-aided design, CAM, computer-aided manufacturing. We've had all sorts of different software programs and the like. But there seems to be this confluence now of a set of new technologies that are taking us to another level. And essentially around the notion of sensors, as sensor-based technologies gotten much better, much cheaper through what's called MEMS and mechatronics. It's just a lot easier to have sensors everywhere in the factory. We all know that this device has multiple sensors. It knows direction, it can do temperature, all sorts of things. Second related to that is just simply the connectivity, advanced Wi-Fi, LTE, which is really the first wireless system designed for the internet, and then better software and control systems. And so that's really what we're going to talk about today. It's an interesting issue, and I think particularly one that has a lot of international implications, because just like the internet is a global standard, when you go to China, when you go to India, when you go to any country, your internet works. We really need to make sure that when we develop essentially Industry 4.0, that we develop it around global standards so that we can get the scale economies that we need. So we're going to start, we're going to have it moderated by two moderators. And I'll start first with Dr. Robin Mishra, whose head is all the way on my left, on my right. Robin is head of the Science and Technology section at the German Embassy here in town. He has a law degree and a PhD. He used to be assistant to the CEO of the RTL Group, Europe's largest broadcaster. He's worked in TV as well as in print media in Germany. Immediately on my right is Josh New, who is a policy analyst at ITIF Center for Data Innovation and does much of our analytical work on the role of data and how data is driving the new economy. Starting all the way, next is Barry Ives. Barry is the Director of Advanced Technology Programs at Lockheed Martin. In this role, he focuses on development and coordination of enterprise S&T strategies, particularly with government research agencies. He previously worked at MC10, which is an advanced materials company in essentially stretchable or flexible electronics. Those of you who have been following the NNMI initiative, the Obama administration has the National Network of Manufacturing Innovation. They just announced the Flexible Electronics Center out in Silicon Valley just recently. And then prior to that, Barry was also a deputy director in the Tactical Technology Office at DARPA in the Defense Department. Next is Professor Dr. Peter Ligensmeyer, who is the Executive Director of the Fraunhofer Institute for Experimental Software Engineering in the Kaiser Water.
Very good.
Okay. For those of you also who don't know, the Fraunhofer system is this wonderful system. It's really been in place since the early 50s, I believe. And this was actually inspired us to ITIF to put on an event with the Fraunhofer folks a number of years ago, which then inspired the administration to start its NNMI initiative, which is roughly modeled after Fraunhofer, so we're really pleased you could join us. Since 2004, he's had the chair of software engineering, dependability at the Department of Computer Science at the University of Kaiserslautern. And then since 2014, he's been the president of the German Informatics Society. Diego Tamburini is the manufacturing industry strategist for Autodesk. For those of you who don't know, Autodesk is one of the leading companies in the world on such a computer-aided design, everything from buildings to movies, and in this case, in manufacturing space. He acts as Autodesk's evangelist on thought leadership in industry, and prior also engaging with the media and companies. And prior to that, he came from Microsoft, where he worked in the Microsoft Dynamics development team, working on the cloud release for ERP. And the next is Dr. Anna Katharina Wittgenstein, who was appointed chairwoman of the board for Wittgenstein's North American operations in 2013. Wittgenstein is a German family-owned company, one of the famous Mittelstands, if you're familiar with that, sort of the secret sauce of German industrial strength, this great mix of middle-sized companies, family-owned, that are at the cutting edge of advanced manufacturing. Wittgenstein is a company of over 300 million in sales, operations in 40 countries around the world, and is committed to be a world-class partner for intelligent mechatronic drive technology, servo systems, and mechanical components. The company is also a key driver of Germany's 4.0, Industry 4.0 and IoT initiatives, and an active member of BMPI organizations in the U.S. So, with that, I guess I'll start, and Josh, you want to kick us off?
All right, so before we get started, just as a reminder, we will be tweeting this throughout from our Twitter handle, @DataInnovation. If you have any comments or questions during the panel, please tweet using the hashtag DataInnovation. So we're going to be doing two parts of this panel. The first half will be moderator Q&A, and then we'll switch to audience Q&A for the second half. And then this event will also, we're recording this, and we'll be posting it online, and it should be up within a couple days after this on our website.
Okay, so thank you, Robert. Also on behalf of the German Embassy, and the spelling of Kaiserslautern was great, so we'll have a very interesting panel here. But I have to say that we are at the end now of a 2 days workshop organized by the German Embassy, the German Ministry of Education and Research, and the National Science Foundation about IoT and about possibilities to work together in this area. And perhaps we can also come back a little bit to that. I think there are a lot of possibilities to work together. There's cooperation, there's of course competition also in this field, but perhaps we can start with the question what Industry 4.0 is. I mean, we heard during these workshops a lot of terms like reliability, usability, standards, systems, interoperability, dependability. But perhaps let me start with a very practical side and a question to Mr. Pius and to Mrs. Wittgenstein, who know this very much from their business perspective. So what has really changed? How has this technology really changed your work? And how does, from your point of view, the factory of the future look like?
I can start, everybody. Yes. So I'm Barry Ives from Lockheed Martin, and thank you for inviting us here today. So Lockheed Martin, as you may know, is a global national security company. We make a lot of large-scale systems like satellites and aircraft and maritime systems, mainly for government customers, especially the Department of Defense. And so many of our systems are, you know, not just individual systems, but they're really systems of systems. And we have very complex supply chains and production flows. And so we rely very heavily on advanced technology for developing our manufacturing and production systems. We have very large networks of large and small businesses who contribute to us as part of our supply chain network. We have a kind of philosophy about manufacturing production that we call digital thread. And it kind of involves flowing information from beginning to end, starting at the really early stage design process, and flowing all the way through manufacturing, quality control, and when we field our systems to our military and other customers, it really continues. So many of the themes that underlie Internet of Things, you know, for us, would the equivalent would be individual pieces of smart technology that go into much larger and more complex, warfighter systems. So, a pilot's helmet when he's sitting in the cockpit of a fighter jet is really an IoT kind of device for us. You know, when we build small or medium-sized aircraft that might be unmanned, that could be part of a much larger system, that almost operates as an IoT device too. And so, the flow of that information is tightly linked to the way the users have to operate. We think a lot about how the information must flow and how we can restrict the flow of information so the user can have access to only what he needs and not be flooded with information.
Okay. So Wittgenstein is a designer and manufacturer of components and systems for the machine building industry. So we manufacture gears, motors, electronics, and assemble them that go into bigger machines. So that's what Wittgenstein does. And we've long used advanced information communication technologies in our manufacturing to plan production, to optimize it. And I think the next step that we're seeing with the industrial Internet of Things is that all of a sudden these things become all interconnected, and it's, in essence, it's what we see is Internet of, or Industry 4.0 would be the application of internet technologies to all of these different products. Okay, so all these to all these systems. So let me give an example from everyday life. Today, my smartphone knows when I'm usually off work. Knows when I have an announced appointment, and half an hour before I have to leave work, I get an alert from whatever app is on my smartphone that tells me, well, traffic to home is okay, probably, just the normal half hour. And then on the way, it alerts me, oh, maybe there's a congestion, and it gives me ideas of, what alternative route to take. And I'm just waiting for the day when it suggests me who to call to notify if I'm late, or that it starts rearranging my appointments that I'm running late for. So that is the world that we're living in today in our personal lives already, or we're very close to it. And apply this to the manufacturing world. And imagine you're steering and controlling not only your machine, your individual plant, but the whole supply chain like that. You know, you're sitting in a chair, and you're manufacturing your whatever part you're doing from your chair, and you can control and make decisions from your smart device. And I think that is what the Industry 4.0 is. We have a totally different approach at managing and managing our production systems with the help of internet technologies. And for me, the core is as well, as I said, this is why I use the smartphone example. Smartphones are there to make things easier for us. We just love using them because they're so easy to use, they help us. And think that into, put this into a manufacturing. Have a manufacturing supply chain be easy to use, easy to manage, just with the tip of your finger. That's what Industry 4.0 can do for us.
Great. So both of you touched on the fact that basically connecting all these parts of your manufacturing process, the guy sitting in the chair, the pilot who needs to be able to operate this highly advanced technology on it. That indicates that, the way that manufacturing is run is fundamentally changing. The skills needed to drive advancements are changing. The workforce that was originally maybe people working on an assembly line and operating machinery is now people sitting in a chair operating all these advanced systems powered by analytics. How have you seen your workforce makeup change in the past couple of years? And how do you see that going forward? So an issue that a lot of people are very concerned about is what's called the data science skills gap, is that pretty much worldwide, higher education is not producing enough people, not necessarily data scientists, people who actually know how to work with data and make value of all the data coming off of these things. So has that impacted your industries already? Do you see that being a significant problem? What would that mean if you don't have enough workers that can address those issues? Anyone else?
We're a small and medium-sized company, and we're very dedicated to to educating our own people. We have about 10% of our employees in constant apprenticeship and training programs. And for years, we've already started to, you know, start mechatronics education. We have our engineers that do work with not only mechanical but mechatronic systems, and increasingly use embedded software in those products. And when you manufacture the or design these products, eventually you need people, you know, across the whole value creation that are able to deal with these products. They have to be able not only to design but also to design manufacturing processes for these products, to assemble them, to make them, to test them. So once it's starting with products, it goes across the whole spectrum of the workforce. So it is already affecting the workforce, and we need to bring an understanding of how mechanics, electronics, and software work together in a product. But with the new technology, we also have to make sure that people understand how I can use broader software systems and data analytics to work with what these products can provide. So it's really something that is across the whole workforce. If we don't have those people, we won't be able to benefit to develop the business models that these technologies allow. And if we don't have those business models in place, if we are not able to tap the opportunities of these technologies, somebody else will. Or our product is no longer differentiated from others and will get under price pressure. So I think it will have a long-term business impact on our company. So we really need people that are able to play with all these technologies at the same time.
This is true. Yes, I might add something to it from an academic point of view, of course. It's obvious that we have to modify the programs, the master's and bachelor's programs at universities. So we have to have more knowledge about data, statistics, and things like that. But this is not the complete answer. I'm convinced that the answer is not so simple. So it's more complicated, because nobody wants to replace engineering expertise with data expertise. That's not the answer, because in Industry 4.0, we need both. So it's engineering, traditional engineering, mechanical, electrical engineering, computer science, plus all of these things that come with the data that penetrates these processes. And to be honest, I don't really have a good answer to that question, how to do it, because you need a very wide qualification, and you need a certain depth of that. And the question is how to do that within a regular program. So I'm convinced that these, well, various sectors that we had in previous industry, you said, okay, I'm a trained mechanical engineer and I can build cars a lifelong, that this will not longer exist. And the question is, how do we train people in such a way that they are capable to handle all these interfaces between different disciplines that we get, between electrical, mechanical engineering, computer science, the data aspects, and so on. So I'm convinced we will see very remarkable modifications also in academic programs in the near future. By the way, the German Society for Informatics currently is in the process of releasing recommendations for that, how to modify computer science programs in Germany.
Yeah, I'll definitely second the mechatronics expertise, the data analysis. But from the point of view of someone from a company that makes software for designers and manufacturers, one of the things that we see as most impactful from the IoT is that the design, the mindset of those who are doing design needs to change, because now you are you need to design products, devices, machines with connectivity in mind. And that changes the picture completely, because you have to think, okay, now my machine is going to be part of a bigger system that is going to have some type of mission. So you're optimizing from the point of view of the system as opposed to the point of view of the product itself. And of course, there are areas of knowledge that particularly manufacturers that manufacture traditionally mechanical products, now they are facing that they need to ramp up very quickly. I mean, things like software and electronics, but also communication protocols, communication standards, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, you name it. Those things are foreign to many companies that produce valves and pumps, and they have to learn all this stuff.
We invest heavily at Lockheed Martin in training of our workforce. So we invest very heavily in vocational technology for our current workforce, but we also are great supporters of STEM education, science and technology, engineering and math education. For example, we're supporters of the USA Science and Engineering Festival that will be coming up in DC and in Washington. It was mentioned before, the National Network of Manufacturing Institutes, which are a public-private partnership sponsored by government agencies like the White House OSTP, the Department of Energy, the Department of Defense, and academic institutions. I think there are six of them now. We're primary supported members of all of those. And we believe we're developing, sort of technologies to inspire and bring in, new talent, and to train the talent that we have to operate in a very high-tech work environment, very distributed environments where our teams are distributed by space and time, and also operate across company boundaries, and investing in the kind of technologies that the gentleman mentioned just a moment ago that involve tight, what we call an engineering coupling between electrical and mechanical and software systems, development of new design tools that cross over those boundaries and help us to create systems that will work harmoniously even when they operate in network system, system type architectures.
I would like to add something. We've heard now a lot about that we need to have software knowledge, data analytics knowledge. But the question is why, I want to go a step back, the question is why do we do all this incremental things, industrial incremental things? We want to create additional value either for our customers, or we want to optimize our own production. So both of this is related to business processes, either within one company or across different company boundaries. So I think also management, the leaders of the companies have to understand increasingly much more what they can do with those technologies and how business models can work in such a world. So management education needs to incorporate those topics and have a basic understanding about what the underlying technologies can do or not do. And I think also we need process specialists who not only come from an IT perspective and create these wonderful IT systems, but that who really understand the underlying business and are able to develop new business models by combining those both worlds. So it's a lot of either combining it in one hand by changing education or making sure that people can really work in teams, have a basic understanding, and then can then work in teams to create these new values for our customers.
Okay, talking about the workforce, I think we cannot do that without referring to an actual survey released yesterday by the World Economic Forum that all this development may lead to a loss of 5 million jobs, and I wonder if you would like to comment on this. Is this a real danger? Will there be new jobs? I think there are then maybe fears of the society of many people to lose their jobs that really existed, and now they are fears to be replaced by a robot or whatever. And on the other hand, perhaps we can talk about the customers. Ms. Wittenstein mentioned them. There are also people saying, well, there might be a social problem, a justice problem, people who have access to IoT devices and people who just have not. And I wonder if you could perhaps comment on these two issues, job loss and inclusion of customers.
Yeah, I mean, there is no doubt that automation and technology in general, and this is not just true for the IoT, it impacts the nature of the jobs and the skills that are needed. So, for a period of time, some people will find themselves that they don't have the right skills. So I've heard something that I like, a quote that says that a robot will not take your job, but someone who can program the robot will. So the skills are different. The technology always moves faster than society and education, so there are always these bubbles of job loss that are unfortunate. But in general, jobs will be better, they will require more skills, and I truly believe that the pie just gets bigger. So in the longer term, automation technology has always been good for society, and IoT is not an exception.
I think the history of industrial revolution is that jobs were modified all over again. This is not the first time. Okay, when the third industrial revolution took place and computerized automation facilities were introduced, much manual work was not really necessary any longer, and people had to be trained to handle the new equipment. But well, the experience shows that those who were really able to push the development, finally, at the end of the day, had benefit from that. So I'm totally convinced that these things will take place. And the question is whether we will do it or others will do it. So my recommendation would be to think carefully and to try to really move things into the right direction. And I would really appreciate if we could do it together, the US and Germany and maybe Europe as a whole. I would really appreciate that. And the other point about access to IoT, well, currently these technologies require a kind of active use. So you have to take out your smartphone and do something, typically. But I'm convinced that this will be changed. The change will be that these systems will be seamlessly integrated into life. So you would probably not even see them or recognize them. And I think the problem is not integration. The problem is how do you make sure that, for example, your privacy is not violated? So how do you switch that off if you don't want to share data? So we have these two problems, of course, participation on the one hand side, but I think that problem will disappear to a certain extent, and another problem will come up, and we will see what happens. Nobody knows, it's just speculation.
So on the question of workforce disruption and potential jobs loss, as others have stated, this is a continuous process of disruption and reinvention. We believe that by active involvement of our workforce in training and in developing solutions for the future and engaging them in the process of education and in recruiting the best and brightest from the emerging workforce, from the university and academic environments, we can meet those challenges together. What we often find is that in our manufacturing and production lines, some of the best and brightest solutions are actually coming out of that workforce and right off the production lines, the insights on how to make changes and improve. By engaging those people directly in the development of solutions, we can bring the whole team along. On the question of inclusiveness for customers, I think part of the solution is to broaden our manufacturing base together with our international partners so that we can make things more economical and more easily accessible. But in terms of use, a lot of our research, which again is often government focused, government customer focus, is aimed at what we call human machine interactions, helping machines that you wear or that you sit in or that you operate not only function in very sophisticated ways, but part of the ways in which they are sophisticated is that they observe their human operators in such a way that they can be unobtrusive and subtly respond to changing needs. For example, if an operator becomes tired or fatigued, the system might change the way it interfaces to become much more simple and safe.
So
building off this notion of the need for greater skills training to kind of come with the workforce, the workforce disruption that will take place due to the increase in automation. So education is just one aspect of the public goods that governments provide to kind of facilitate this change. So, I mean, many of you mentioned that you have your own workforce training program within your internal company, but that, of course, can't handle the load alone. The government plays a crucial role in educating the majority of the population with those fundamental skills. But those are that's just one aspect of this public good nature that the government can provide to support the growth of the Internet of Things. The other ones include radio spectrum and appropriate regulations. Are there any sort of public goods that you think are necessary for your companies to better adopt these Internet of Things that the government isn't providing as well as it should?
So the example that you mentioned is a big example for us. Spectrum sharing is an important issue. Many of the pieces of the spectrum that historically have been controlled by government, especially military customers, are now being increasingly shared among commercial businesses and made available for cell phone providers and many other forms of communication. One of the ways that our business is working to accommodate that is better spectrum sharing and management systems that can agilely detect what parts of the spectrum are being used and leave a light footprint behind. If some piece of it is being used at one frequency, we can use another piece at a different frequency. That's kind of our way, not only of protecting our military customers in the field, but also being good citizens, not stepping on adjacent spaces in the spectrum when we operate side by side with commercial operations.
Okay, I can talk a little bit about the German situation. Germany, since quite a while, has a so-called digital agenda, and that's I think that's good. Okay, so politicians seem to perceive these topics as being relevant, and this is really remarkable. So it is a high-level approach that tries to address many of these topics that come in the neighborhood of digitalization, which is not only technical topics, but also technical topics. Of course, the German Ministry for Education and Research tries to set up appropriate research programs that try to tackle the technical issues. But it's more than that. It's, for example, law matters. Things that could be violated very easily based on these data that is collected, personalized data, may not have the permission to store that, to process it in an arbitrary way, and so on. So I think there is the perception that these topics are important. This is already existing in politics. And I see already the right activities, but there is a certain distance to go still. So I'm convinced we don't even know all the technical questions, and we surely don't have the answers for them, and there is very much going on in the neighborhood of that, but I think most people really accept that we have a challenge, and if we could handle that, we would have opportunities for our economies and also for the people. So I'm convinced, of course, things could be enriched in a certain way, but things are developing quite well.
Okay, I think if you really want to use the Internet of Things to its biggest extent, you need to make sure that it's not something that is reduced to few companies or within groups of companies, but it needs to be established in the wide industry. So how do we make sure that there's not only just some companies that use these technologies and the opportunities they create, but how do we make sure that other companies, and especially smaller, medium-sized companies, benefit from these topics too? They might not have in the beginning the understanding of what they can do with it. That's where it starts. They might not have the resources to invest in their equipment, because many of them have machines that were bought years ago. They don't have these capabilities of connectivity yet. So you even either have to, you know, make additional investments, replace the machines. And companies don't do that just because the technology is cool or there's excitement about it in political discussion. Companies do that because they see an economic benefit for them or business and a profit for them. So smaller and medium-sized companies especially, they need to see real benefits that come from these new technologies, from these new business models. And of course, a government policymakers cannot tell them, you know, this is your new business model and this is what you should do. But I think what can be done is to provide platforms and networks and support those networks where information and best practices are exchanged, where a small, medium-sized company leaders can see, you know, this is how it works in this industry, how can I translate it to the other industry? But they need to have real-life examples. They're not inclined to listen to propaganda. Sorry for using that term, but that's, you know, you have to make it really, really practical. So, and then, you know, whatever, from a policy standpoint, you want to do in terms of supporting those networks, encouraging investment, that's what the policymakers have to figure out, what, how they want to support it. And then I can also only second the topic with the data security and privacy topics. If I exchange large amounts of data across value chains, how do I make sure that I'm not just giving away my data and somebody else benefits from it, but that I get a fair exchange for the data that I'm providing? So how do we orchestrate this? What are regulations that help us make this exchange easier?
Just adding to that, I mean, obviously, besides the infrastructure, the iron required to connect these devices, I mean, mind you, there are predictions that there will be 30 billion devices connected by 2020. So there is a lot of bandwidth, and in manufacturing in particular, it's also latency that is required to satisfy IoT manufacturing. But there is also the if you step back and think about the internet and the growth of the internet, one of the things that contributed to the boom was that they figured out protocols to have computers and software talk to each other. So HTTP came along, XML, that really fueled the growth. Now with IoT, you have a similar problem but multiplied by the variety of devices that you are connecting. I don't think personally that we'll get to one single communication protocol for all IoT devices. It'll be very verticalized, home devices, factory devices, security devices. So there is the need of how do you solve the Tower of Babel problem. And of course, that has to do with protocols, interoperability standards, and the government there, I mean, obviously, I don't think that it's a place for the government to kind of set those standards, but definitely help the coordination of the development. And one thing that is also particularly important is that the data and the protocols need to work across country boundaries, of course.
Let me perhaps add another US-German perspective to that. I think we can learn from each other. There's an example that the United States National Network for Manufacturing Innovation, designed to advance innovation in manufacturing with new technologies, is kind of modeled after Germany's Fraunhofer Institutes. On the other hand, one of the participants of our workshop said that he cannot remember having seen an area of business where you really need to work together, where there's a strong need for cooperation, but on the same hand, you have fierce competition between companies, between academia and all that. So in which areas do you think can both our countries really work together to the benefit of both our societies?
Well, we tried to figure that out yesterday and the day before, and I think there are some opportunities that we see. Of course, I think Europe and especially Germany perceives itself as being very strong in the engineering disciplines. So car building, automation, also chemistry and things like that. Right. So many of these things. I wouldn't say we don't have IT competence. Of course we have IT competence in Europe, but especially the very large standardized IT-based systems usually are heavily influenced from the US side. So operating system, database systems, cloud technology. So I think there is much engineering competence in the United States as well. So it's not a black or white story. So we are both a little bit gray, but I think there are different expertises and different traditions on both sides. And now we see systems where these competences have to come together. Okay, Industry 4.0 will not work without appropriate IT systems being included, and it will not work without good engineering. And so I think this could be a nice thing to address, because we will have to answer many, many questions, and we should select those for preparing the answers that are the best selection to do that. And I'm convinced that we will have many opportunities to bring the special competences here and in Europe and especially in Germany together for the sake of these ultra-large network systems that combine, well, traditional technology, machines and so on the one hand side, and information technology on the other side. It's very clear.
So some of the specific areas where international collaboration is very important is in the development of common standards and the adoption of what we call open architectures that focus on common use of interfaces. So in very complicated systems, sometimes it's in order to lower barriers for contributors across the value chain to work somewhat independently and still contribute in ways that are mutually complementary, we have to develop some common standards for how systems will interoperate, plug together, if you will, at larger scales when they become when they enter the network or when they're operating together. And so a focus area of these NNMI institutes is to develop in each of these distinct manufacturing-oriented domains, both for the design side and for manufacturing compatibility reasons, to focus on joint standards and open architecture reference standards that will enable much larger supply chains to work together in a more open and often distributed and parallel way, and have confidence that their systems will work together. Another area to be considered is in cybersecurity. Many of the devices that we call IoT are smaller. They might be mobile. They might be small devices. You know, something in your refrigerator, or something built into your home, or something built into your clothes. They have to be very power aware. They've got less information processing capability, and yet they still have to network. They use lighter, less complicated protocols than a heavy system that you might have on your desk. And so that introduces the possibility for greater security vulnerabilities. So another area for collaboration across country boundaries is adoption of common security standards to help prevent vulnerabilities from ruining the potential value of certain types of devices.
Great. So I think we have time for one last question before we switch to the audience Q&A. And so this is something that was touched on, the role of the Internet of Things in competition. Yes, the US and Germany are in competition in many of these industries, but what I want to discuss is specifically how does smart manufacturing and the Internet of Things as a whole benefit international competition? So say, particularly ambitious or forward-looking companies that might have, you know, adopt connected systems, are they put at a disadvantage when the country average might be less advanced? So when supply chains that you rely on don't always use connected technologies, when things like custom inspections don't always rely on connected technologies, factors outside of one individual company's control that are slower to get on board, how is that affecting domestic and international competition, and what can governments do to kind of resolve those?
think just very, very shortly, if you talk about the value of supply chains, so I think it depends very much on, you know, are you able to develop these technologies along a certain supply chain? So if the rest of the country is in a different situation, for my personal, you know, for my company, it's not important as long as my supply chain is working that way. So, and then on the other hand, in order to really influence the competitiveness of the partners, you really, from my standpoint, you really have to work along different value chains, use these value or supply chains as a starting point that then, you know, develops those technologies into other areas of the industry. So don't try to make everybody connectable or connected without having an idea of how this really works together. And that's where, again, customs regulations, whatever, they have to work along a certain specific value chain and then develop, go from the business the application and develop the regulations and needs from there. Otherwise, it just takes too long.
Yeah, I will probably add to that, if you think that about the IoT, at the end of the day, it's about putting sensors in things and collecting data from these sensors and extract some insight to do something or to improve something. So with that in mind, the IoT represents an opportunity, I mean, not just inside the factory to orchestrate manufacturing, to optimize manufacturing and energy consumption in the factory, but also in outside the factory. By virtue of having products connected and generating data 24/7, it enables all sorts of services, value-added services like predictive maintenance, energy optimization, design optimization. So to the extent that you are allowed, and this, by the way, this ability to provide attached services is becoming a competitive differentiator in some industries. So having said all that, the ability, to the extent that you enable the companies in the country to access the data, to extract insight to that data, you are increasing their competitiveness. So let's say an example that I love to relate to is a company called Big Belly that they have these connected trash cans. So, but it's just a trash can, it doesn't get any more unsexy than that. But by being connected, they revolutionized the trash collection service. So if you have a company that is offering that type of service in country A, and another company that just produces trash cans, obviously, of course, the one that is connected is gonna be more competitive. So just by virtue of being able to connect the products, use the data, extract insight, they became tenfold more competitive than their competitors.
So just in a previous company where I worked in flexible electronics, we did a project for the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation that involved building networks, small devices, doing a collection of blood and right on the spot doing blood and chemical analysis in the third world. And not only does this kind of small networked IoT type technology have the ability to make it much easier to manage public health worldwide on a scale never before seen and collect much more accurate data than ever before so that public policies for health and other kinds of responses can be much more targeted and precise and economical. But they also provide a kind of substrate for future businesses. So they lower barriers for development of cottage industries and businesses across the world, certainly in the developed world, but also in the developing world as well.
And yeah, feel free to ask anything you would like to know or to discuss with the panel.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Huffman. I work with Access Partnership. I have a question about the regulatory perspective. I heard in our conversation today, Internet of Things, and I'm thinking about smart cities, connected cars, and you start to see a very multi-stakeholder approach, and we talked about also expanding the pie, and the value of a lot of this is data sharing, data collection, data usage. Simultaneously, we're living in a post-Snowden world where you increasingly see data localization. I believe Russia's data localization policy was enacted on the first of this year. You're seeing a lot of activity in Germany as well. I'm just wondering how, if you're looking a little more long-term, or even near to medium term at times, how you plan to reconcile data localization with really maximizing the power of Internet of Things across boundaries, supply chains, et cetera.
Thank you. I might have at least a partial answer to that, which is also a little bit wider than the aspect that you talk about. It's not only about data localization, it's about data usage controlling. So the question is it sufficient that currently we either give away our data or we keep it secret? So we have these two options. I think most people would accept to give away data for a specific purpose, saying, okay, you can get my data, but you are only allowed to use it twice, or for 4 weeks, or within a certain area, which is data localization, okay? And the problem is that currently we cannot do that. Now, the current situation, data access control, you can keep your data secret, it's protected, but you cannot benefit from giving away the data if you keep it secret. Or you give it away and you don't have it under control any longer. You cannot control whether it will be, well, distributed to some places that you don't like, whether it will be attached somewhere where you don't want to see it, and so on. So, I think we have to enrich data access control by data usage control, where you could specify certain obligations. And these obligations, of course, should then be controlled. Somebody has to make sure that your obligations aren't violated, and there should be a technical solution for that. So I see a certain movement into that direction, and that will handle all the other aspects as well. It will handle local aspects. Of course, it is also a law matter and has to do with politics, but currently we don't have the option. We can keep data away, or we can keep it secret, and if you keep it secret, big data won't fly. So it's very clear we need something in between. And I know for sure that researchers are working on that problem.
Ken Gerber with the National Academy of Engineering. I love the case example of the trash can. It's called Big Belly. Was that the name of it? Can you expand a little bit more broader on how things like that, how changes like that with the Internet of Things will affect business strategy and business models more the macro level?
Yeah, sure, certainly. So one is the like I say, with the imagine that you manufacture a product, and all of a sudden you can see the information at the customer side, everything you want to know about your product 24/7 constantly. So first of all, it enables, like I said before, new services that you couldn't deliver before. Again, predictive maintenance is one of the most talked about, but also energy optimization, all those things. So for example, if you're monitoring your machine at the customer side, you can tweak some parameters to make it more energy efficient. So that's the delivery of services is one. But more profoundly, in the business models, the IoT enables something that is known as product as a service. whereby you don't sell the product, you don't sell the spare parts, you sell the outcome. So the quintessential example is that the G and Rolls Royce powered by the hour. I don't know if you've heard that it's basically the engines for the airplanes, they don't sell their engines to the airlines, they sell kilowatts. So the manufacturer takes care of service, maintenance, efficiency control, all that stuff, and the airline pays for kilowatts. Other example, a famous example is here in Washington, Philips, they provide lighting as a service, so for some areas of Washington. So they are not selling light poles and light bulbs, they are selling lumens. So the city just pays for a subscription to light, and the manufacturer takes care of replacements, and make sure that the product is energy efficient, make sure that the quality is right. So the manufacturer assumes most of that risk. So those things, those type of products and business models and services were virtually impossible before the ability of connecting the products with the IoT.
Hi, I'm Brian Collins, Senator Baldwin. I just wanted to ask a question that Ms. Wittgenstein, I think, brought up. How do we reconcile, basically, you made a great point about making the business case for IoT. How do we reconcile that with another thing that I think was mentioned on the panel about creating a platform for best practices? You know, Big Belly obviously had a great breakthrough with this, you know, using IoT there. They may want to guard their, you know, their new value creating business model. How do we encourage them to sort of share that across industries?
I think it's a dilemma with everything about sharing and about with innovation. So I think, you know, one idea is really to bring people together that are not from competing, not competitors in the same industry. But these are things that are very general in innovation management, I think. So it's nothing new. It's probably a different level because if you're not sharing a product, but all of a sudden you're sharing a business model, which requires a little more insight in your internal feelings of the company. But as you've already, as you've indicated, it's what we do with product innovation and other technological innovations too.
And mind you, is that just connecting innovation and competition, that's great. Is the first one who does it is the one who gets the competitive advantage, then that competitive advantage disappears. It's kind of the story of innovation in general. But keep in mind that it's not just connecting the machines and providing some sort of service. That can be copied fairly easily. It's the intelligence that you apply interpreting the data that you are getting, that's the secret sauce of companies. So that is not easily copied.
Questions. One on NMMI. My understanding was that the money that the president asked for his budget for NMMI had not been appropriated, so that the experience was not as large as it could be. So, like, you know what the state is exactly. Second question is anything done to work with colleges, universities in the U.S. My experience in talking to a number of CEOs of mostly only French subsidiaries in the U.S. and they tell me that when they recruit people, sometimes out of the best colleges, Ivy colleges, they are very disappointed by the performance of people who have a very good theoretical formation, but no practical experience whatsoever. So compared to people they can recruit in Germany, or people they can recruit in France, there is a big handicap there, and I don't know whether anything is being done with colleges to convey that impression. And then a lot of caution on the title, nobody should compete with Germany in terms of manufacturing. I spent 5 years in Germany, head of the economics section. to compete. It's like what you call soccer here. So the British definition of soccer is 22 people on the team and the other German players.
Somebody is probably better positioned than I to describe exactly the state of the NNMI funding. My informal understanding is that there's effort this year to try to lock in that funding, past the end of this administration. The government has multiple agencies have collaborated very actively in the development of these networks. But as I'm sure you know, they're not only funded by the government, they're also co-funded by industry. So industries such as ours are become paying members into these consortia, which are academic, government, and industry partnerships. And we focus together on early stage, often pre-competitive technologies and early stage intellectual property that can be widely shared across these member organizations. So one of the things that we supported very actively and are seeking to help, institutionalize this structure. We also have a large network of colleges and universities, not only all across the United States, but in many of our partner countries, and in England, India, Japan, all over the world. And there are, we have particular strategic relationships where we work on internship programs, so that to take one out of many, many examples, Drexel University, which is in Philadelphia, has a program where their engineering students don't just do like a four-year college degree, they do a five-year degree, and one of those years is heavily dependent on joint internships. So we take in a lot of their engineering students and train them for several months at a time. And by the time they graduate with that undergraduate degree, they've got practical experience in the workforce.
Well, talking about your, students that lack practical expertise, I see the current development as an opportunity. So I'm convinced that if you would talk to computer scientists, don't matter whether it's in the US or in Europe, 15 years ago, most of them would have shared a certain opinion about the ingredients of a bachelor's or master's program, saying, okay, this is our profile and we know that for sure. In the meantime, we have very many practical applications for computer science in different domains. All these industries that come along the Internet of Things, cyber physical systems, Industry 4.0, you call it. And of course, you can ask yourself, would this student be qualified to handle this problem? Or is this lacking in his or her profile? And as I said, currently my own society, the Society for Informatics in Germany, they triggered a process that finally led to some recommendations saying, okay, we have revised the content. And the reason is that we need people that have a different profile. And my feeling is that this profile will be a little bit more practical, which is not against theory. Okay, every real scientific discipline has a good theoretical basis. But there might be some replacements in the theory part as well, talking about big data, statistics, which didn't show up in every computer science program in the past, according to my experience, and will be included. And of course, there will be some more practical parts in the educational programs. And currently the problem is more or less how to adjust all that appropriately so that finally at the end of the day, you generate somebody who knows everything but not very deep. So this is more or less the problem. How do you shape the profile so that it is really good and a good basis to build upon, because training on the job nevertheless will be necessary also in the future, of course.
Frank Pfefferkorn from the Advanced Manufacturing National Program Office. So my question is, and I'm this comes a little bit from my own personal as a private citizen, not wanting to put a Nest thermostat in my house or be able to unlock my door with my iPhone yet, because I don't trust the systems or that somebody can't hack into them. So my question is now for companies or your supply chain, how much of resistance to or is a lack of trust, or is it a lack of knowledge and expertise that might be slowing down the adoption of Internet of Things? Or is one more than the other, I guess is the question, right? Is it lack of workforce and knowledge about the systems, or just a risk analysis issue, or lack of trust in the security of the systems?
I think it's totally clear that it's not guaranteed that these systems will work well. So we have to handle ultra-large systems. They are very heterogeneous. They will have a high degree of autonomy, and we will generate very many open questions where we had good answers for the previous architectures when the systems were closed, static, you had clear boundaries, and things like that. So we have to make sure that these things behave in a dependable way, whatever that means. That's a mixture of a variety of properties. It's safety, security, availability, usability. It's necessary to always be sure you're on safe ground. And if we cannot handle that, then we will lose trust. And I'm totally convinced that trust is the necessary precondition for acceptance. So if people don't trust, they will not accept that. It's very clear.
Go back to moderator Q&A. Yeah. Shreyas Nekla, also from the Advanced Manufacturing International Program Office. I was wondering, with connectivity of devices and machines, obviously the security issue was raised, that's an issue, but are there regulations in place or being worked on that require, particularly for industrial Internet of Things, require manufacturers of connected valves, machines, whatever they may be, to disclose that these devices are connected and being monitored because of security concerns? So are there regulations in place that require that disclosure? And this applies even to commercial products. You know, do I know that my phone is necessarily monitoring? Is that revealed to me at the time of purchase? And what concerns does that generate?
So keep in mind that in those, and you made a very good point, the problems, privacy, security, all this of industrial IoT are different from the general IoT. So let me start with that. And privacy is not as much as an issue as it is security. I mean, are you invading the privacy of a boiler if somebody knows that it's 78 degrees inside? Well, I don't know. but now, that what I do know about regulations and security is, and it makes a whole world of difference whether the connectivity is read-only or read and command, that you can actually control. So, of course, when there is control involved is where the security is an issue, because you could do bad things to the equipment. So in those, for example, in automotive, anything that you do that is IoT-ish is only read-only for now. You can read temperatures, speeds, and all that, but you cannot, in theory, issue a command to steer the car or brake. So that makes a whole difference. But as far as I don't know about it, if there are regulations that you need to disclose, I would imagine yes, but I don't know.
Sometimes there are very non-intuitive mechanisms that can break down the boundary of security in ways that even the manufacturers themselves didn't suspect. There's some interesting case studies about industrial controllers that were very well protected, SCADA systems and so forth, that controlled industrial equipment and dams and so forth. But they had, basically their kind of help desk support enabled some remote person to get into the system and check the health and welfare of that system so that they could do repairs. But there were connection points into the main control that would enable cyber intrusion and somebody to take over that system. And that created new vulnerabilities that nobody really expected. And government researchers at Idaho National Labs and others were able to show that that actually, you know, was a real vulnerability that could create safety concerns. I think in the area of wearable biosensors, which is an area that I've worked in for commercial devices, there's an expectation that the data you gather would be used to help you improve your health or improve your physical training or whatnot, but there's always a kind of concern about compliance with HIPAA regulations or an expectation of privacy. Who else is going to have access or be able to use that data?
Anyone else?
So let me think the moderator is part of asking one last question. Maybe it's more of a comment, but we mentioned, you mentioned how Europe, or Germany in particular, is, you sort of said, how strong are you on the IT versus engineering? Really good at engineering, good at IT, but really good at engineering. We're probably really good at IT and okay at engineering, good at engineering. And yet, when you listen to the debate in Europe, as we do, particularly out of Brussels, but frankly out of Germany as well, you hear this sort of narrative that says, we essentially don't like not being IT leaders, and we sort of have envy and resentment towards the U.S. for, what is that new term, the Apple, Google, Facebook, it's Apple, Google, Facebook, anyway, it is this sort of derogatory term. And you just see this in for example, the European Commission just came out with a little study that said that reported, even though I think the study was wrong, that reported that Europe runs an app deficit of like, $40 million or something like that. And our response was, first of all, we don't think that's right, but secondly, so what? You also run a trade debt surplus with America of $8 billion in cars and another $8 billion in machines. And I guess the question really is, has Europe abandoned this notion of sort of comparative advantage? Because we're really impressed with what Europe is doing on 4.0, because it's to us, it's kind of like it's taking your natural comparative advantage, which is really about engineering and mechanical things, and then adding on to IT. And yet, you see this other narrative in Europe, which is we really don't want the Googles of the world, the Facebooks of the world, the Autodesks of the world. We don't want those companies to succeed because we want to have that space as well. So that's obviously a controversial question. But I'm just curious if you have any thoughts on that. Because it seems to me, ultimately, the space would be that you would really be clearly in the lead or among the leaders in sort of this integration of IT and mechanical.
Well, if you ask me personally, I do not have any problem with this. So if I would have problems with that, I would not have organized the workshop that we had yesterday and the day before. So I believe, and this is, I think, the statement that potentially every real researcher would make, that cooperation always is good for both sides if it's the right cooperation. So science is a global thing, has ever been. And now we see that more or less by the type of systems that we develop, we have to bring things together that used to be separated in the past. And of course, with different traditions. This, way to start a new business in the United States goes very fast, is very business oriented. I find that very impressive from a German perspective. We also have startup businesses in Germany, but I always associate the quote, I have to have my own business with the United States. And this is more or less internet technology, it's focused on IT, and in Germany there is a strong tradition to keep, let's say, traditional companies alive. If you think about the large German companies, the car builders, large companies like Siemens or so, they are usually more than 100 years old. And they were always capable to somehow go through the transformation and go into the next century, like that. And if it comes to engineering, the next challenge is to do this engineering IT integration. And I think it's a good idea to talk to them and ask, could we do something better if we would do it together in US and Germany or Europe? And we try to figure that out. And well, if we would be successful, maybe we're going to have a common research program.
Yeah, some comment or in addition to this. I think, personally, I haven't been involved in that debate, but I think what many German companies or industrial companies envy is the easiness with which Google, Facebook, Apple, whatever, you know, apply these new technologies, because in very many cases, they're not, you know, they don't have any legacy systems. You know, an industrial company has manufacturing sites, it has machines, it has products that have been designed over years. So it takes a while to get these products onto the new level. Whereas a startup, American startup culture, you start with nothing and you take things that are there, and especially in the data world, you just take data, you don't need big investments. And so that is something where Europe says, goodness, I'd like to be that fast, like as fast as they are. But you know, we're coming from a different background, so we have to have a different innovation approach. And I think, on the other hand, you know, isn't that, you know, a little bit of envy? Isn't that good just for competition? So I think I wouldn't mind the debate, because it starts creativity. So you know, let's see. In the end, both the companies have always prospered together. So well, let's see. Yes. Compete a little bit, and then in the end, we're better than the rest.
Now, there's good competition and bad competition. I'm not sure that DG Comp is actually a supporter of good competition. one last quick question, which we haven't, I'm sort of surprised, hasn't come up. China. I don't know, Diego, you want to go? China has a big, they have a national IoT strategy, which we've written about, we've talked to them about. How do you all see China as a player in this? They have their own, we just issued a report yesterday ranking countries on contributions to global innovation. China, frankly, ranked quite low. How do you see that playing out, Diego?
Think about it.
Or anybody.
Yeah, with China, the problem, again, is, we go back to it was mentioned before, the trust. Particularly if it is some multinational company that is implementing IoT in its factories or in its products or services, obviously anytime that you have to deal with China, there are trust issues about data transfers and hacking and all that. So that in my view would be the biggest challenge. On the other hand, the numbers are just the sheer amount of population, it makes a great case for IoT services, particularly the ones that are probably sponsored or provided by the government. It could be interesting.
Barry, did you want to jump in?
Well, I would just reinforce that. I think to the extent that we can influence our collaborators in China and in other countries to respect intellectual property boundaries, which I think is part and parcel of the trust equation, the more that we'll be able to collaborate on an even playing field with them, and that will only spur innovation and lower the barriers for growth of the economy in this area.
Great. So one last comment, and then we'll close up. We talked a little bit about impact on jobs, and I would just commend you to, it was a study we just reviewed about 2 weeks ago on our blog site, where there was a very good academic study that looked at the impact of employment among companies that are advanced automation and robotics adopters. We found out that they actually end up creating more jobs than their non-adopters. A study we did that looked at countries' manufacturing, share of manufacturing employment, as also related to the amount of robot intensity. In other words, how much are companies adopting robots and advanced automation technologies versus how many jobs they have? And the answer is the more of their manufacturers adopt robotics, the higher share of manufacturing employment they have. So it's exactly 180 degrees counter to the sort of intuitive thing. I was talking recently to some members of Congress, and they brought up, they had been to Germany, and they visited a factory, and there weren't that many workers there, and therefore, ipso facto, automation means no jobs. I'd point out to them that Germany has about 60% more manufacturing workers than we do as a share of your economy, because you are so advanced in using technology, you're able to gain value added, and to your point about business models and higher margins. So I think the evidence is very, very clear, and this is fundamentally not about getting rid of jobs, but upskilling jobs, and it's about, frankly, higher wages. That's another thing we don't hear talk a lot about, but German manufacturing wages are significantly higher than U.S. manufacturing wages, and yet you want a trade surplus with China and a trade surplus with the world because you are so productive and innovative and have moved into higher value. So IoT, that's, I think, one of the reasons why the U.S. is looking at IoT so much, because we want to move down in that direction. First of all, I thought it was a great, great panel, and I want to thank our colleagues here for joining us this morning. Thank you all for attending, and then please join me in thanking our panelists.